So we have been looking at stability of asymptotic stability of integration schemes, numerical solvers for ordinary differential equation initial value problem. And then we looked at certain cases, right? We looked at explicit Euler, implicit Euler, trapezoidal rule, okay? And we carried out analysis of under what conditions the difference between the true and the approximate will vanish, as at least asymptotically, okay? So for example, for trapezoidal rule, I considered a simple system dx by dt is equal to ax, a is less than 0, and x naught is the, or xn is the initial condition, okay? And then we wrote this difference equation. When we use when we use trapezoidal rule, we use this difference equation, and we finally found that the dynamics is governed by En plus 1. So this is actually Pade approximation of e to the power ah. Okay, and then I pointed out that this is nothing but if you call this vector as z n plus 1, call this matrix as b, and call this as zn, okay, then we have this linear difference equation z n plus 1 is equal to b. We have looked at equations of this type earlier, very, very similar equations, except that the context was different. We looked at iterative schemes. There was no time involved. Here n represents the time instant. Earlier it was k plus 1 is equal to b into ek, and the criteria was you know, the spectral radius of b should be strictly less than 1. Okay. Now in this particular case, what are the eigenvalues of B? Okay. If you do this, you have to solve for determinant of lambda I minus B is equal to 0. Okay. And with this, you will get lambda minus There are two eigenvalues. Spectral radius should be strictly less than 1. Okay. If the spectral radius should be less than 1, then absolute of each eigenvalue also should be less than 1. Spectral radius is the maximum magnitude eigenvalue. Okay. So I need 1 plus 1 minus ah by 2 upon 1 plus ah by 2 to be strictly less than 1. And anyway, since a is less than 0, okay, we know that e to the power ah is strictly less than 1. So this condition is satisfied because a is less than 1. This has to be satisfied in order that asymptotically error goes to 0. Error between the true and approximate. Okay. So our en is nothing but x star n. X star n is the true solution and xn is the approximate solution using trapezoidal rule. In trapezoidal rule it turned out to be this. Okay. We had derived similar conditions for other cases. For explicit Euler, we got condition 1 plus ah strictly less than 1, right? And this tells you how to choose h, because you are given a problem. So a is given to you, you are asked to solve a particular problem, a is given to you, you have to choose h. So this tells you how to choose h. H has to satisfy this condition. For implicit Euler, we got condition 1 upon 1 minus ah strictly less than 1. Okay. Now the question is, how do I take this analysis to a higher level, that is to multivariate case. Okay, we are still talking about a scalar case. I want to graduate to the multivariate case. That is, again, for the multivariate case, the situation where I know the solution is when you have linear ordinary differential equations, okay, given the initial condition. Just now we looked at those kind of multivariate equations. So I want to extend this analysis to that case. Okay. I want to extend this analysis to that case. Now, we will have some more complications there because you have this A matrix, okay, and it is a full matrix. Here, in this particular case, A is a scalar and life was simple. Okay, how do you deal with a case where A is a matrix? Okay, are these ideas clear? First of all, for the scalar case. Okay. Likewise, if you go on deriving these things, you know, let's say if I derive it for a second order Runge-Kutta method, what will I get? I'll just write down that what you get for second order Runge-Kutta method. Second order Runge-Kutta method, you will get here 1 plus ah plus a square h square by 2 factorial. And here you will get 1 plus ah plus a square h square by 2 factorial and ah. And so this will be case for the second order Runge-Kutta methods. Okay. And then the condition will reduce to, so this is for this will be the matrix equation for the second order Runge-Kutta method, and the condition will reduce to mod of 1 plus ah plus a square h square by 2 factorial should be strictly less than 1. Okay, and so on. See, if you can you guess now what will be for the third order Runge-Kutta method? You can see the pattern. First order Runge-Kutta method is explicit Euler. Second order Runge-Kutta method is, we have looked at Huhn's rule and so on. So that will give you this. Third order will give you 1 plus ah plus a square h square by 2 factorial plus a cube h cube by 3 factorial. Mod of that should be strictly less than 1. Okay. If those conditions are satisfied, then only you get approximation error asymptotically going to 0. Otherwise, it will not happen. Okay. So one can derive for scalar case. Okay. Is this clear? Okay. Let's graduate to the vector case. let's graduate to the vector case. In the vector case, there are one or two different variants the way we can introduce this. One way is, you know, let's take a case where, well, we know that for a vector case, if xn is the initial condition, okay, we know that the true solution xt is equal to e to the power, or we can write a general solution from starting from 0. Let's do that. At t equal to 0, x is equal to x0. This is my initial condition. Then the true solution is xt is equal to e to the power at, okay, where A is a matrix. Here A is n cross n matrix and x belongs to Rn, okay. X is a n cross 1 vector, A is a n cross n matrix, and you are given initial condition which is a vector. The true solution at any time t is written by e to the power at x naught, okay. Using the same trick that we did earlier, okay, for the scalar case, it is not difficult to show that in the new notation x t n plus 1 is equal to e to the power a h x t n. Using this is true solution, this is star, okay, this is star, it's possible to show that, okay, or in other words, the true solution evolves according to x n plus 1, x star n plus 1 e to the power a h x star n, okay. The true solution evolves according to this. What about the explicit Euler method, or what about implicit Euler method? Okay. What about explicit Euler method? Explicit Euler method will be, explicit Euler method is x n plus 1 is equal to x n plus h fn, right? So this is nothing but xn plus ha xn, right? So this is nothing but I plus ha. Now we are not dealing with scalars, we are dealing with vectors and matrices. Pre-multiplication, post-multiplication, these are very, very important. You cannot take it lightly. Whether it xn should be before or after, you should be very, very careful when you write. Okay. What will be the case for implicit Euler? Can you write down? Just try. And trapezoidal rule. For implicit Euler, what we are going to do is something like this. X n plus 1 is equal to x n plus h f n plus 1. So this will give me x n plus h a x n plus 1. Okay. So if I rearrange, I get I minus a h, or I minus h times a, this matrix into x n plus 1 is equal to x n, right? I am just taking this on the left hand side, okay. What I get here is x n plus 1 is I minus HA inverse mind you I cannot write divided by I have to write pre multiplied by inverse that's the only correct way okay similarly trapezoidal rule what will it be trapezoidal rule will turn out to be x n plus 1 is equal to I minus h by 2 a I plus h by I minus h by 2 inverse I plus h by 2 a into x n just I follow the same thing for trapezoidal rule I will get this thing here okay now the question is how do I do analysis of evolution of error okay I want to do an analysis which is very very similar to the previous case okay so I want to analyze e n which is x star n I want to analyze how this error behaves okay so let's see whether we can get some insights into this now we will visit trapezoidal rule and implicit Euler a little later let's start begin with the simplest one explicit Euler method okay what is my explicit Euler method x n plus 1 is equal to I plus h a into x n okay now I want to find out well if I subtract these two okay I will get e n plus 1 okay I'll get e n plus 1 is equal to I plus h a e n plus e to the power a h minus if I subtract and rearrange I'll get an equation which looks very very similar to the scalar case no difference okay for the time being well how do you define e to the power a h e to the power a h is defined as I plus h a plus h square a square by 2 factorial plus and so on right so if h is very very small which is the condition for Euler integration right h is very very small then you can think that first two terms will suffice in terms of approximating e to the power a h and the later on the terms afterwards can be neglected okay so for the sake of analysis let's assume that this difference is very very small just to get initial insights okay we'll do the formal analysis little later so formal analysis in the sense by combining the two difference equations and the way we wrote in terms of a matrix that we'll do later so right now let's assume that this difference is negligible and this is what dominates let's look at this part of the equation okay now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this idea of diagonalization so I'm going to make an assumption that I'm to do analysis I'm going to do two assumptions one assumption is eigenvectors are linearly independent. If A is diagonalizable, eigenvectors are linearly independent, then I can write A as psi lambda psi inverse, where psi is an eigenvector matrix with columns as eigenvectors, lambda is a diagonal matrix with all the eigenvalues appearing on the diagonal, okay, lambda 1, lambda 2. So second assumption I am going to make is that real part of lambda I of A, that means, is strictly less than 0. To do the analysis, I am going to make one more assumption that all the eigenvalues of A are in the left half plane or left half complex plane. Why do I talk about complex numbers? Eigenvalues need not be real. Given a matrix which has all real entries, I can have eigenvalues which are complex. Okay? I can have all the eigenvalues which are complex. I am talking about the systems which have all the eigenvalues with negative real part. Okay? Advantage of this is that such systems solution will decay to 0 as t goes to infinity. You can show this very, very easily. So I am considering a special class to get insights. Okay, and using this special class of system, we are going to get insights into what is happening. Okay, how does this help me? Okay, so let's go back and start looking at our error dynamics. Here, you know, En plus 1 is equal to I plus HA let's look at this part. Okay, I am going to write this as psi inverse is I, okay, plus H psi lambda psi inverse En, okay, which is nothing but psi I plus H lambda psi inverse En. Is everyone with me on this? What is psi? Psi is a diagonal matrix. Sorry, psi is a eigenvector matrix. And what is lambda? Lambda is a diagonal matrix with eigenvalues appearing on the diagonal. Okay. What will be I plus H lambda? Okay. I plus H lambda is nothing but 1 plus H lambda 1. Okay. 1 plus H lambda 2, 1 plus H lambda n. This I plus H lambda is also a diagonal matrix because lambda is a diagonal matrix. I plus H lambda is also a diagonal matrix with 1 plus H lambda I appearing on the main diagonal. It's fine. Right? This is appearing on the main diagonal. Now, error equation, this particular equation is same as something that we have encountered earlier. Okay. When will you say that you know, error will asymptotically go to zero? What is the condition? Spectral radius of this I plus AH should be strictly less than 1. We can translate that condition to you know, spectral radius of I plus HA should be strictly less than 1. Okay, I can also say that lambda of I plus H A lambda I. That means each eigenvalue of this matrix, okay, each eigenvalue of this matrix should be strictly less than 1. Now the question is, what are the eigenvalues of I plus AH? If you look here, okay, if you look here, this actually is nothing but diagonalization of this matrix. What are the eigenvectors of I plus AH? What are the eigenvectors? They are same as eigenvectors of A. Okay, the columns which are appearing here in this matrix are nothing but eigenvectors of I plus AH. They happen to be same as eigenvectors of A. We have just proved that. Okay, this is the diagonal matrix. When you do diagonalization, what appears on the diagonal matrix? Eigenvalues. So this must be the eigenvalues of this matrix. Okay, so my condition for stability translates to 1 plus H lambda I should be strictly less than 1 for I is equal to 1, 2 up to n, where lambda I are where lambda I are eigenvalues of A. Okay, lambda I are eigenvalues of A. So I plus H lambda I should be strictly less than 1 for every I, for every eigenvalue, this should happen. Okay, this is the condition, this is the condition under which the error will asymptotically go to 0. Okay, we are looking at right now approximate error dynamics. We have neglected one component. So this is what will happen. This is the condition under which, so now the condition that we had earlier is a subset of this condition, because earlier we considered A to be a real number, real negative number, right? Now I am expanding it and saying that we may get complex numbers, and then the stability condition in this particular case, it translates to 1 plus H lambda I, where lambda I are eigenvalues of A. This should be strictly less than 1. So actually what is typically done is, in the complex plane you draw stability envelope, you draw a stability envelope or the region in which for the values for which the you will get stable dynamics of the error. In this particular case, this will be 2 minus 2 minus 1 0, and there will be a circle here. This is lambda H plane. This is imaginary, this is real. Only in this region, okay, only in this region, if lambda H value, if lambda I times H value falls in this region, okay, we can translate this to we can draw a region in which this condition will be satisfied in the complex plane, okay, and these are called as, this is called a stability envelope for explicit Euler method. Likewise, one can derive stability envelopes for implicit Euler, for trapezoidal rule, and so on. What will be the case? How will you analyze this case? In the implicit Euler, you have E n plus 1 will turn out to be I minus or approximate, because we are neglecting one small part, I minus H A inverse E N. Okay, how will you write this? What will this turn out to be? See, this is I minus H A inverse. I minus H A inverse using the same trick. Okay, that is psi inverse minus H psi lambda psi inverse. Okay, I want to take out psi, I want to take out psi inverse. Do you remember the rule for inverse of multiplication of two matrices? What is A B whole inverse? B inverse A inverse. So if you use rules properly, you will see that this turns out to be psi I minus H lambda inverse psi inverse. Okay, I minus H lambda inverse. I minus H lambda inverse is very easy to compute. Okay, I minus H lambda inverse is very easy to compute. Diagonal matrix. Inverse of a diagonal matrix is 1 upon each diagonal element. Okay. So, in this particular case, this matrix will turn out to be this matrix here, I minus H lambda inverse, will turn out to be a diagonal matrix, okay, with 0, 0 all of diagonal elements, and the diagonal elements will be 1 upon 1 minus H lambda 1, 1 upon 1 minus H lambda 2, and so on. What is the stability condition? Stability condition will turn out to be, in this case, in this particular case, the stability condition for implicit Euler will turn out to be 1 mod of 1 upon 1 minus H lambda I should be strictly less than 1. Okay, and then you can show when eigenvalues of A have negative real part. Okay, the region of stability is nothing but entire left half plane. For any value of H, you will get, okay, that is not the case for explicit Euler. Explicit Euler, there is a very small region. You have to be very careful when you choose the integration step size. Implicit Euler, okay, even if you make slight error or if you choose slightly larger integration step size, it will not give you asymptotically wrong results. Okay, this is more to get insights. The insight that we get here is that even for a multivariable case, okay, if you use explicit Euler method, you still have to be very careful. First of all, how do you choose H? It depends upon the eigenvalues of A matrix. Okay, how do you choose H? It depends upon the eigenvalues of A matrix. Okay, second thing is, and then. Of course, you should choose the one which is most conservative, okay, because you will get 1 plus H lambda 1, 1 plus H lambda 2, you will get so many inequalities for I going from 1 to n. The most conservative value of H which you get, that is what you should choose, okay, because it may happen that you might choose H for lambda 1 and that may be a wrong H for lambda 2, okay. So the most conservative one you have to choose, the smallest H that you have to choose, which satisfies all the inequalities, has to be chosen. That is very important. Okay, you don't have to worry so much when it comes to implicit Euler. Okay, implicit Euler is implicit weather is relatively much more stable algorithm than explicit Euler. Okay. Trapezoidal rule. What will be? Can you guess if I do a similar manipulation? Okay. It will be for trapezoidal rule. It will be 1 plus h lambda I by 2 upon 1 minus h lambda I by 2. It will turn out to be very similar. Okay. For the trapezoidal rule. Okay. So. Well, so I said that the exact analysis would be little more, you'll have to consider the entire matrix. So you can write En plus 1 x star n plus 1 is equal to, I'll just directly write for the trapezoidal rule, for the implicit Euler. For implicit Euler, it is I minus HA inverse e to the power a h minus I minus h a inverse. This is null matrix e to the power a h into e n x star n. Well, you can show if all eigenvalues of a have negative real part, then x star n will asymptotically go to 0. This is not difficult to show. So ultimately it will boil down to eigenvalues of this matrix, because you have to look at determinant. If you call this matrix as B matrix, then you have to look at determinant of lambda I minus B, roots of determinant of this, okay, which will turn out to be nothing but roots of this and roots of this. If eigenvalues of A have negative real part, these will always be stable, or these will asymptotically go to 0. You have to worry about this part. Okay. And this part will change depending upon whether you are using implicit Euler, explicit Euler, Runge-Kutta, whatever. If you are using Runge-Kutta, you will get I plus H plus A H square. Second order Runge-Kutta will give you that. If you are using third order Runge-Kutta, this will change and this will change and so on. Okay. So how you approximate you know, e to the power h will change depending upon the method that you are using, but the way of analysis finally remains same. Okay, we are going to look at in literature you can find out the stability envelopes for different methods, and that way you can compare different methods, which methods are, you know, where it is easier to choose integration interval, where it is difficult to choose integration interval. So one can actually compare methods based on these. Now the last part. Okay, so this is all fine. Spectral radius of this should be less than 1 and so on. What about the real problems? Real problems are never linear ordinary differential equations, and we are trying to get insights. Why we use linearity? Because for linear ordinary differential equations, we know the true solution. Okay, the true solution is e to the power ah or e to the power at. This is not the case for a nonlinear, general nonlinear differential equation. So what do? Okay, I can do a local analysis using Taylor series approximation locally. Okay, so I can extend this idea to a nonlinear case by doing repeated local linearization. Okay, again, the analysis of stability of these methods is fairly involved topic, and then I cannot do a justice in a course in which I have to pack many things. So as to prepare you, idea is to sensitize you that there exists something called stability analysis, stability envelopes, and if you really get doubts whether this method is performing well, whether I'm choosing h step size correctly, go back and look at stability envelopes. Okay, those are available in the literature, and you should, if you want to have a relative you know, comparison of different methods, one basis could be using looking at these envelopes, stability envelopes. So if I have a general nonlinear differential equation, dx by dt is equal to f of xt, where x belongs to Rn and f is a function vector. Uh, and f here is a n cross 1 function vector. F here is a n cross 1 function vector. Then way I could do analysis, I am currently at xtn is equal to xn. Then what I can do is locally I can write dx by dt is approximately equal to f at xn plus dou f by dou x evaluated at x is equal to xn. Locally I can differentiate, okay, and then rewrite this right hand side as dou f by dou x at x equal to, or with the notation that we have used earlier, dou f by dou x at x equal to xn into x plus fn minus dou f by dou x n. Since xn is known, fn is known, this matrix is known, this is a constant, this is a constant vector, okay. Your equation becomes similar to a linear differential equation. This is dx by dt is equal to, this is my A matrix, this is a Jacobian matrix, okay, and into x. So this becomes similar to, this becomes similar to dx by dt is equal to A x. My A is this matrix, local Jacobian. Okay, I can look at eigenvalues of the local Jacobian and do the analysis. Okay, I can look at eigenvalues of the local Jacobian and analysis. But the problem with this eigenvalues of the local Jacobian is that eigenvalues will change as you move in time. Okay, so suppose you happen to choose, you know, integration step size based on time 0 Jacobian, okay, and the Jacobian eigenvalues change drastically as you advance in time, okay, what is giving you stable results in one region may give you unstable results in another region. So okay, that's where the fix of variable step size comes handy. When you don't know anything, use variable step size method, okay. But if you want to understand, if you want to get insights, you could look at local Jacobian, eigenvalues of the local Jacobian, and if eigenvalue of the local Jacobian do not change too much in the region in which you are integrating, you could choose one fixed step size and use it for solving your problem at hand. Okay, so the way to extend this analysis to the nonlinear case is through local linearization, repeated local linearization. Okay, so each Jacobian will have a different eigenvalue actually, but typically Jacobian will be a smooth function of eigenvalues. Eigenvalues will change smoothly, but they can change, and if they change over a period of time, they change drastically, then choosing integration step size becomes tough. In such cases, the fix that we described right in the beginning, variable step size integration, is the best. Okay, so MATLAB's most popular solvers, RK45 or RK23, are variable step size solvers. Okay, when you give some 0 to h, internally it will, you know, keep dividing h till it gets, and it asks you for an accuracy. So it keeps finding out h for which you get a desired accuracy, and it proceeds. Okay, so all this things I presented because you should know how to analyze these methods, how to have a critical look at these methods. Okay, practically when you actually solve problems later on, you might use variable step size. Okay, but you should know if you are getting stuck somewhere, okay, you probably should look at the eigenvalues. And when I'm going to describe something in my next class, differential algebraic systems, these eigenvalues will play a very, very crucial role. Okay, we have something called stiff systems. Stiff systems are one in which some eigenvalues are large, some eigenvalues are small. Okay, if some eigenvalues are 10 to the power minus 5 and some eigenvalues are 10,000, okay, in a large differential equation this can happen. How do you choose integration step size with respect to 0.0001 or with respect to 10,000? Okay, in such cases you get what are called as differential algebraic systems. You approximate certain derivatives to be 0 and you only solve for certain other derivatives, and so on. So we will look at differential algebraic systems, but you have a notion of stiff systems. Stiff system arises from eigenvalues of Jacobian, and we look at the ratio of the real part of eigenvalues, negative to positive, or the ratio of real part of eigenvalues of Jacobian, maximum and minimum values, that gives us what is called a stiffness ratio. If a system is stiff, you have to use a stiff differential equation solver. MATLAB will give you stiff solver. It's called ODE15S. S stands for stiff solver. Okay. So if you have this eigenvalue disparity, you have to go for stiff solvers, and you should know about this business of stiff solvers. And so basically this is touching tip of the iceberg. There's a lot more to it, but you can look at the references I have given and try to understand more about this.